Good day and welcome back to Chemistry Videos. My name is Clarissa Sorensen-Unruh and we are continuing our discussion about thermodynamics calculations with practice problems. Right now in this video, what we're going to do is we're going to do delta G and KQ. Awesome. This is the most common kind of question that we give. And it's basically having you calculate everything at standard conditions. It's using formation values and so on and so forth. Now, the way we calculate this, we need to know a couple of pieces, right? If we want to calculate delta G naught, which is at standard conditions, then we need a delta H naught, and we need to have an S naught, and we need a temperature as well. The temperature was not listed here, so we have to assume that it's the standard condition temperature, which the temperature at standard conditions is 25 degrees Celsius or 298 K. Okay, that's for standard conditions for thermodynamic values. Okay, that's not the same as STP in the gas chapter. Totally different temperature there. Okay, so just FYI, that's what we're talking about. We're still talking about 1 atm of pressure, by the way. Okay, so we have this equation. The way we're going to figure this out is we need to find H and S first. The way we find the H of the reaction, if we have formation moments, is we know it's the sum of the moles of the products times the delta H's of formation of the products minus the sum of the moles of the reactants times the delta H's of formation of the reactants. And you'll notice that in Gen Chem 1, I make a big deal about not necessarily writing this equation on the board or on the glass, as per se. And the reason why I do that is because I want to make it a process. I want you to have kind of a sense about it. But in terms of plugging it into your calculator, it's actually easier if you use the equation. And since we're at the place where we're doing this a lot, we're going to do it how you would plug it into your calculator to do it all at once. Okay? The only problem here is that the moles are obtained from the balanced chemical equation. And right now, my balanced chemical equation, it's not so balanced. So let's balance it. All right, I have 12 C's over here. I need 12 C's over here. I have 22 H's, which means I need 11 H's here. Notice I have 11 O's, and I don't want to change this number. So that 11 O's cancels out with those 11 O's, which means that I need a 12 right here as well. Okay, so in terms of doing this, now that I have my moles of reactants and products, I can actually plug it in. Let's do delta H of reaction first, and then we'll do the S of the reaction the exact same way. All right, so this is keeping a lot in mind. You have to figure out what the delta H is for the products first. So you got to figure out that these are products, and maybe label this as such. These are reactants. And so I'm going to start, because the products come first, with CO2, right? I'm going to put negative 393.5 times its coefficient in the balanced chemical equation times 12. And then I'm going to add that to the other product, which is negative 241.8. This is for water, right? Put this reactants over there, times 11, which is in the reaction. So the sum of the products, that's the sum of the products. Now I'm going to subtract out the sum of the reactants. So I have C12, H22, O11. My value for delta HF is negative 2221.7 times 1 in that equation. Plus for O2, let's do a little products moment here. All right, plus for O2, it's 0 because O2 is an element in its natural state. Doesn't require any heat on our part to make it, times 12, which is what's in the reaction. All right, so now what is my delta H reaction? Plugging this in the calculator, I just make these square brackets a second set of brackets in my calculator, and I can calculate this all at once. which is really super nice and way easier. Than doing the whole process. You are still, of course, welcome to do the whole process if you so wish. All right, I got a cool number like -5160.1, and this is kilojoules per mole. Boy, that reaction releases a lot of heat. Woohoo! I'm gonna write that up here too. -5160.1 kilojoules per mole. That's H. All right, let's erase all of this and do the exact same thing for S. I do the exact same thing over again, but now I'm going to do it for S. So I'm going to use the S values. And we're going to erase the products of the reactants. Hopefully we know where those are at this point. If you don't, you've come a long way in chemistry. Without knowing that. And it's kind of shocking that you would have passed Gen Chem 1 without knowing that. But you know, if you don't know it, now's the time to learn. All right. Ah, glass, clean glass. One of the most lovely things ever. All right, so at this point, we want to do S, right? So S, let's do delta S of the reaction, since we have H. That's going to be the exact same deal. The sum of the moles of the products times the S now for the products. And that could be an S of formation. Sometimes it says S of formation, sometimes it doesn't. Just depends on what you're using. Usually we're using the back of the book. The appendix tends to say these things. Give you a big chart. But if you aren't using a book or you don't have a book handy, then the way that you would find these values if they were not given to you is through the NIST web book. Have room down here? NIST. Web book online. Yes, you can Google it. Yes, the value may be right. I would not necessarily trust it. The National Institute of Standards and Technologies is actually where you get the values from the back of the book. So that's the one to trust. Okay, and you just Google NIST web book, it comes up. You just plug in your equations or your formulas. It comes up with values. Life is awesome. Great, okay. So let's go back to S of reaction over here. All right, the moles of the products. Gotta remember where the products is, that's C. I'm using this column now, right? So 213.7 times the number in front of CO2 in that equation plus 188.72, this is for water, times 11, which is what the number is in the balanced chemical equation in front of water. And then I'm going to subtract out 360.24 times 1, which is the number in front of sucrose. Actually, this is the general formula for all disaccharides. So it could be sucrose, it could be something else. And then you have 205.0. Notice that for elements in their natural state, while they're H, and actually their G's are zero, their S's are not. Okay, so you actually have to calculate this out. Let's do this. 213, do double parentheses here. 213.7, actually I'm gonna cap that. Just use my calculator for a minute. 213.7 times 12. Plus 188.72 times 11, plus, about to plus all kinds of things, minus 360.24 times 1 plus 205.0 times 12. And I plugged it into my calculator. If I call the square brackets a second set of parentheses, I plugged it in exactly as you see it here. Okay, 1820.08. Now recognize, folks, the units. The units for H were kilojoules per mole. The units for S are joules per mole K, which means that there's a thousand difference between these two units. That is actually really important for our next step. Okay, so I'm going to write this up here as well. So S, we know delta H is equal to this. S is going to be equal to, where am I going to write that? I'm just going to write it right here. Is equal to 1820.08 joules per mole K. All right, let's erase this and find G. And once we find G, we can find K pretty easily. All right. Fun stuff. Okay, so in terms of our last step, we're just going to plug and chug these. The big recognition here into the original formula, which is this. The big recognition that you need to make sure that you got is that G needs to have the same units added or subtracted from one another. In other words, you can't put kilojoules in for enthalpy and joules in for entropy and expect that you can actually subtract those out. You cannot. They have to be in the same unit. Whatever unit you choose is fine, but it better be in the same unit. Let's go ahead and convert H into joules. If we convert H into joules, then we're essentially doing kind of this deal where 1 kilojoule is 1,000 joules. So we're just multiplying that value times 1,000. Here we go. We got delta G is going to be equal to negative 5160.1 times 1,000, which is a ridiculously large number, right? 5.1, it was ridiculously large to begin with, but now it's even bigger. There we go. That's the number of joules per mole contributed by the heat of the reaction minus, that's delta H, right? Minus T, which we said was 298K because it wasn't given. And I put it in K because S has the units of K that I need to cancel out, times 1820.08 joules per mole K. And notice that the K's cancel out, and I'm adding joules per mole and joules per mole. This throws off so many people in the exam. Well, actually, in everything that we do, this little conversion that you can't add two different units together. It's actually a big thing. All right, so now I did this, and I got a number like negative 557.02483.84 joules per mole. Wow. Or if you wanted to redo this in kilojoules, because it's a little easier to think about, it would be negative 5702.5-ish kilojoules per mole. Negative 5,702.5 kilojoules per mole. Wow, that's a lot of energy given off by this reaction. Okay, that's delta G. In terms of K, now what I'm going to do with K doesn't have to involve any of this. All of this was for G. I needed to use all of these for G. You can actually calculate G if you have delta G's of formation. You can actually calculate G the same way that you calculated H an S, but you have to have the delta G's of formation. If you don't have the delta G's of formation, then you're finding H and S, and you have to go through this equation, delta G equals delta H minus T delta S. That's kind of the only way to go if you are given H and S values. Lovely way to go. Fun, good, enjoyable, kind of integrates everything, but you'd have to do that. Okay, now that I have G, how do I integrate G with K? Well, here's the interesting thing. This is actually derived from an equation. So let's talk about the equation that it's derived from. We know that delta G equals, we don't know that yet. Okay, so we know that delta G equals H minus T delta S, but there actually is one more equation that you should know. And that is delta G at non-standard conditions can be related to K and Q. Okay, how do I do that? It's negative RT, actually it's positive RT, times the natural log of Q over K. Okay, now, separating this out, right? Delta G can equal RT natural log of Q. And since this is a natural log and it's minus, I mean, it's a quotient, you can subtract out natural log of Q minus natural log of K and distribute the RT at the same time, right? I don't know if that was easy, but there's a step in here that I skipped, right? Delta G equals positive RT, and then you can do natural log of Q minus natural log of K and get to this, okay? This value right here, we call delta G naught. So in terms of this equation that we're gonna use, delta G naught is equal to negative RT times the natural log of K. Kind of fun, kind of interesting. I think math is fun, but if you don't get any of this other stuff, it's totally fine. It's just a recognition that that's where this delta G equation of that relates K to delta G. That's where it came from. Okay, I'm looking for K, right? So if I'm looking for K, then I would maybe first divide both sides by negative RT, right? Delta G naught over RT is equal to the natural log of K. And then I'm gonna get here where I get rid of the natural log, which means that I E both sides, right? And E is gonna be negative delta G naught divided by RT. So E to the negative power of this equation, that's what K is. Okay, so let's plug in our numbers. K equals negative, all right. Because R here, by the way, is in energy units, as it will be for this entire chapter. So that's R equals 8.314 joules per mole K. Since that's true, and this has joules in it, I need to use joules, the joules value, which is this ridiculously long number, right? So negative, and then since the equation has a negative and my G has a negative, I have to do a negative in here too. 5702483.84 joules per mole divided by 8.314 joules per mole K. And again, we're still assuming that it's 298 K, right? Oi, squeaky marker. Notice that in this case, when you do this, everything cancels out, which is exactly how it should be. K is unitless, remember? All right, so now I plug this in. And let's get this number first, right? So I have this cool number. So negative that divided by 8.314 divided by 298. And I got a number like E to the positive 2302, right? And if you actually try to plug this into your calculator, I'm pretty sure I know what's gonna happen next. Ooh, Ooh, you get, I wish we could zoom in to my calculator right now. What it says is overflow error, which means that it's such a ridiculously large number that my calculator can't even calculate it. If you try your iPhone or your iPad, sometimes it can calculate it. Usually if it's in the hundreds, it can. Sometimes if it's in the thousands, it can. When you get an overflow error, what that means is that it's a ridiculously large number. That's okay. You can just leave your answer like this. And perhaps if you really wanted to emphasize it, you could say ridiculously large value. So we know that this reaction is not just a little spontaneous, it's ridiculously spontaneous. And that's good for us when we're trying to get, when we eat sugar and we need to somehow convert it into something our bodies can use. That's a good thing. Okay, having said all of this, this is the most common kind of problem. I've given you some extra information, like how you can calculate G at non-standard conditions. You can calculate it G at non-standard conditions through this equation as well, if you have a non-standard H and S as well. But those are kind of the big ideas. Until I see you again, adieu.